Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, everybody. We'll get started in just a minute or two. I'm seeing the attendees jump up. Thanks for joining us today. As the as people are gathering, it would be great if in the chat people could introduce themselves, give us your name and location. It's great to see where everybody is in the world. I'm in London, UK at the moment. Moldova. Welcome. Australia, yay. Fantastic. South Africa, France, that's Jeffrey, Dubai, India, Japan. Ah, it's Yuko, hi. Slovakia. All right. So keep saying hello in the chat and we'll go ahead and get started. Please use the Q&A, just a couple of notes first, for your questions. It's great to say hello in the chat, but if you have questions that either the team will be answering as people are talking, or we will select a couple to talk through verbally live at the end. I'm Ginny Hendricks. I'm the Director of Member and Community Outreach at Crossref. And the purpose of this webinar really is to give a mid-year update. We usually save all our updates collectively for our annual meeting in November, but we're going to start doing them half yearly, and this is the first one. So each May or June, we'll have a more practical update on where we are with progress. And we will be recording this and sending the slides. And there are a lot of links that we'll send to you today, but we will summarize them all in an email afterwards. So please don't feel like you need to take screenshots or copy links too quickly. Okay, so what we'll cover today, as I said, it's a mid-year update. So we're going to touch briefly on our overall strategy. We're going to give a bit of a technical update because we've really been focusing on that for the last year or two. And then we'll frame all of our updates around six goals, two of which are new. And if you were to look at a new page on our website, it's crossref.org/strategy. These are the six goals. So we extended the 2018 strategy, and these are the ones that we are working towards in 2025. And the website gives full information about where we're heading over the next few years. And as I say, today, we're just going to focus on one or two projects that are actively underway or have recently progressed. And before we talk through the six goals, as I said, we've been focused on technical debt and paying that down the last year or so, figuring out how to scale our 20-year-old system and operation. And we've been adapting to new ways of working. And we've made really good progress. And we've been removing roadblocks, trying to get more done. So first up, to give a little update on that, is Joe Woss, who heads our software development team. I'll ask Joe to take over now.
Cool. Hi, everyone. I'm going to talk about the software systems that power Crossref, old and new, how and why they were originally built, and how we're maintaining them. You'll hear later from my colleagues about the new features we're planning to build, and I'll talk about how we do that as well. So first of all, what is this all meant to do? Technical debt. Well, technical debt is a natural and often useful part of software development. When an organization is building software, often there is a sensible path to getting the job done. Because we don't have a crystal ball to see into the future, these choices mean that we have to make some assumptions. Whilst these assumptions can help us to get the job done, they can also make code inflexible and make it harder to work with over time. It's important to revisit them and spend time making improvements, or, like monetary debt, the interest can build up. And when that happens, it becomes increasingly difficult to work with the code or deliver the much needed changes. So identifying technical debt in our services isn't always simple. While the symptoms can be technical, the underlying causes can be much broader. We have to ask, what was this code meant to do at the time it was built? And are we still trying to do that thing? These are questions not just for developers, but for the whole organization. Because what might have been perfect for a perfect solution for Crossref in 2001 wasn't right in 2011. And what was right in 2011 might not be right in 2021. Over the past two decades, we've adapted our content system codebase to try and keep pace with our changing role and community. But now we're in a position to make some much more substantial changes. In the past year, we've grown our software development team and started the process of building a new generation of systems. So our legacy content system has been with Crossref right from the start. It handles content registration, XML querying, reporting, access control, membership, funder registry, and many more things. And it was designed to be run in our data center. Although we have made improvements to scale it up over the years, there are some fundamental things about its design that make it difficult to move it all to the cloud, or automatically scale to meet fluctuating demand, or adapt to the ever-changing scholarly community. Our new strategy is to prefer building new functionality in cloud-native technologies rather than try to extend the old content system codebase as it is. We are now at the point where the underlying software design of the content system needs revisiting. The code in the content system was originally built for a much smaller and simpler community. We now have thousands of members who publish much more content. They're more diverse, have more diverse structures, and also publish a much more diverse set of content. We have some exciting plans about our systems to meet these new demands, and you will hear from my colleagues later on in the call. We're going to take two main approaches. The first is building out the product features that you will see on our roadmap. The second is refactoring out common patterns, such as reporting or access control, into new dedicated services. And this will help us build reliable and flexible services for the future. So our new backend technology stack is JVM based. It includes Kotlin, which gives us a smooth transition away from the existing use of Java. We also have some closure. Our new front end is built in Vue.js. We've already made the switch to our new tech stack, and you may have noticed our new login box, which is the first new service written in Kotlin and Vue.js, and it's deployed in AWS Cloud. We've also been very busy moving our REST API to AWS Cloud and use Elasticsearch, and you'll hear more about that later as well. Automation drives our deployment and releases. Some of you may be used to our Tuesday deploys of content system where we have to suspend the queue. Our new services, such as MyCrossref, will be continually deployed to the cloud with no interruption. By using open source toolchains, test coverage, and code quality automation, we can ensure that we build maintainable code that remains flexible but also stands the test of time. By having a robust set of automatic test cases, it will allow us to more confidently pay down the technical debt as it arises. You'll be hearing later about POSI, the Principles for Open Scholarly Infrastructure. One of the most relevant principles here is open source. Most new code bases in Crossref have been open source for the past 8 or so years. But because most of our content registration, access control, membership, XML query, etc., have been contained in the legacy content system codebase, improvements to that have not yet been open. As we make much more deep changes, not only in the code, but the assumptions behind the code, we will continue to do so in new open source code repositories. Open means you can extend it. We'll be implementing all new functionality as fully documented APIs using OpenAPI and Swagger, and this will make it easier for our community to integrate Crossref functionality into their own services. As services are open source, the community will also be able to maybe run components themselves for testing or even contribute code back to us. Setting the bar high on test coverage and code quality means we can be much more confident about accepting contributions from our community. That could be language translations, bug fixes, or maybe even new features. Open source means open issue tracking, and you can find our user stories, bug tracking, and technical debt register on our GitHub account. This is an exciting time. Look out for our new services. So I'd like to hand over to Jeffrey Builder, our Director of Technology and Strategy.
Hello, thank you, Joe, for that. I should explain a little bit about the structure of the technology team. The technology team is made up of three subgroups. The first is development, and that's the group that Joe heads up and that he's been talking about. But I'm going to talk briefly about the other two groups, the infrastructure group and the R&D group. So one of the things that Joe has mentioned in his talk was this issue of moving to the cloud. And one of the questions you might have simply is, why are we doing this? What's the point? And the point, really, I'm going to address two things. One is the major driver of this, and the second is some of the risks involved. But the major driver of this is scale. Our system was, as Joe mentioned, built back in 2000, and it was designed, you know, assuming that there'd be about 1.3 million DOIs. We had 33 members at the time. We probably handled about 3 million API requests back then. And we had one dedicated sysadmin staff. Let's fast forward to this year, 2021. We're dealing with 125 million DOIs approximately 14,000 members. And we handle about 8 billion requests to our various APIs during this time. And if you look at those scales, you know, everything has increased about logarithmically. And you think, okay, well, maybe our staff has as well. But if we go to the next slide, you'll see that in fact, we only have two dedicated sysadmin staff right now. And that's good news and it's bad news. It's good news in that we have, you know, remained quite efficient despite the fact that we've been running our own data center and running our own machines and doing a lot of stuff that requires a lot of sort of manual intervention. But this is not going to scale, and it's certainly not going to take us to 2041, right? You know, if things continue the way they are, you know, ideally we'd have four people, but that's unlikely if we keep having to run our own data center, if we have to scale things ourselves. And the truth is, these are not our core competencies. These are the core competencies of people who run gigantic cloud systems and services. So the biggest reason that we're moving to the cloud is to so that we can continue to scale the way we have, so that we don't increase our infrastructure staff at the same scale that we've increased, for instance, our DOIs or our membership or God forbid, our requests. And so moving to the cloud, of course, is to deal with scalability. And a lot of people might have questions, particularly around, and we can go to the next slide here, around the risk, right? Because as people will no doubt point out, the cloud is just somebody else's computer. And that's true, right? The cloud is just somebody else's computer. But the truth is, this is something that has been more or less true in our infrastructure ever since we started, right? The data center is somebody else's network stack, racks, building. We are using somebody else's infrastructure for lots of different things that we depend on. The key to managing that risk is to actually architect things so that we can easily move things from one infrastructure to another. And so one of the things that the infrastructure team is working closely with the development team on is figuring out how we can actually design our system so that we're not entirely tied to a particular cloud provider, and so that we don't face the risks of being locked into a particular provider in the future. So moving to the cloud is a scalability issue, and we are very well aware of the risks associated with that, and we've got plans in place to try and manage those risks. The next thing that I want to talk about is the other group within the technology, within the technology team, and that is R&D. And if you didn't know that we had an R&D team, I don't blame you. Recently, the R&D team has been fairly quiet, and that's largely because they've been helping the development team through this transition, organizational and technology transition over the past few years. But if you go to the Crossref blog site, and you can go to www.crossref.org/blog, you'll see that the first entry there is a new announcement, and it's an announcement about how we're revitalizing an R&D group. So we're going to be withdrawing the two developers that we have, Esh and Dominika, who have been providing help to the development group over the past few years. We're going to be scaling back their efforts there so that they can focus more on R and less on D. And the reason that we're doing this is because the R&D group has been critical in the past for Crossref's ability to innovate and build new services, not just for Crossref members, but also for the community at large. So there are a whole bunch of things right now that originated in the R&D group that you might take for granted and think have just always been part of Crossref. Things like content negotiation, similarity check, ORCID, Crossmark, all of these things kind of had their very earliest start as R&D projects and eventually got turned into products and new services, and sometimes entirely new organizations. And over the past few years, we haven't had the capacity to do that. We're trying to ramp up that capacity. So in addition to taking Esh and Dominika off of a lot of the development work and focusing them more on R, we're also augmenting the team. Rachel Lamy, who probably all of you know and may have even talked to and met in person, is going to be joining the R&D team over the next few months as the head of strategic initiatives. And she's going to help Esh and Dominika go out to the community, figure out what kinds of things we need to be working on, we need to be exploring in order to provide new services and perhaps entirely new systems in the future. So I encourage you to go and look at that blog post, but that's what's happening with these two R&D, with these two subgroups of the technology team. And I'll hand back over to Ginny, I think, now, right?
That's right. Thank you, Jeffrey. And thanks, Joe, for setting the scene. And that leads us nicely onto, we need a bit of a drum roll, our first ever public roadmap. So Brian's going to walk us through that.
Great. Thanks, Ginny. It's probably a little bit early for drum rolls.
For some of us.
So hi everyone, I'm Brian Vickery, I'm Director of Product at Crossref. And as Ginny just mentioned, yesterday we launched the first ever Crossref public roadmap. To set the scene, I know that for many of you, when we show it to you, if you haven't already followed the link at the bottom to have a look, that there'll be too much information there, but these labels will be extremely useful to you. I'll go through those in a second. And I also know that for some other people, there may not be as much detail as you would like. But as Joe said, most of our development happens in the open on GitLab.com anyway. So that's where all of our issues and epics live. So the roadmap is really designed to be high level information about the things that we're working on, which when you see it is quite a lot. It's not simply a product roadmap. It covers governance, strategy, community initiatives, the Crossref platform that Joe was talking about us building out, as well as the products and services. So we've added more than 60 labels to the roadmap. These will help you, and it helps us to filter what is a single roadmap into something that you might be interested in. I'll just go through these very quickly. Starting on the left, we have some overarching themes. So My Crossref is going to be our new user interface on everything that we do for our members. The Crossref platform is the underlying technology that Joe was describing. Next, we have our strategic goals. As Ginny said, there are six of them, but we have seven labels because simplify our services and enhance our services is broken out because they're slightly different things. Our products and services listed here in orange. Before the content types and other identifiers we work with, so that's journal articles or things like ORCID IDs. In it's mint green on my screen, it's the community at large. So whether or not we're working on something for a journal publisher or for a research funder. The black are the Crossref platform components that we just, as Joe started to describe. Pink is kind of internal projects, things that we're having a real focus on at the moment. And they might be things like observability. That to us, that means being able to monitor our systems, what's happening within them, how data is flowing, whether our servers are up or not. And then in dark blue, our teams. So I'm going to try to do a juggling act and move over to the Crossref roadmap, which should be here on your screen right now. One more second. There we go. So just very briefly, if you were to click on these labels, I think when you first visit the board, you'll see all of these labels expanded. If you click anywhere in those labels areas, they will contract so you can see more of the board. I should say that we're using Trello for this. It's something that a lot of you are already used to using. It's very easy for us to work with as well. I'll just quickly take you through the columns so you can orientate yourselves. We start with research and planning. This area takes quite a lot of time and effort. It's where we're actively discussing things with the community on their needs and wishes. We're discussing things with other infrastructure providers. We're putting our plans in place, understanding the technologies that we will need to use to deliver the solution. Once our planning is done, they'll move into up next. These are things that we have committed to doing in the near term. From there, we'll move them once they're prioritized into in progress. So here we're actively working on the solution for something before moving it into testing. And testing means obviously that we're doing our own QA user acceptance testing, but also that we are working with the community to beta test the solution to make sure that it actually does what you hoped it would do. And then it would move into adoption and engagement. So at the very beginning in the research and planning, the planning told us that there was a need. And now that we've developed and tested the solution, we work with the community to have them adopt the solution so that the benefits can be felt by the whole community. I think recently completed the speaks for itself. Hidden away slightly further down on the far right hand side, you'll see other ideas. This is things that we have been discussing internally at Crossref and possibly with the community, but we haven't really started much research and planning on. And then those ideas, when they get prioritized as high priority ideas, will move into the priority ideas column before they move all the way over to research and planning. So that's the board. In a nutshell, where you, the images disappeared. Some of the cards have a lot more detail in them. They will link to other cards of interest. And on this particular one, where we're talking about our new content registration UI, Sarah has, product manager, Sarah Bowman has posted a call for feedback on the community forum, Crossref community forum. So many of the cards will either link to GitLab issues where there's more detail, or they will link to the community forum where we're actively seeking your feedback on what we're doing. So one final thing, if you're on a desktop, you can hit the F key and if it works. You will then be able to search for the labels. So what I've just done now is filtered the entire board for one of our services, Similarity Check. You could filter the board similarly for event data, content registration, or one of the community groups like the research funders. So that is the outline of the roadmap. We're very excited to have made it available to everybody. It will be updated very frequently. We seek your feedback on the roadmap as much as the things that are on the roadmap. So please do let us know what you think of it and what else you would like to see. So I'm going to hand back now to Ginny.
Thanks, Brian. Yeah, that is really great news. It will be really helpful. There's already a couple of questions coming in about the roadmap. We're going to have time at the end for Q&A, even though I know it's quite late for you, Lisa, in California there. So moving on, we're going to talk now through the six goals. Two of them are new, bolster the team and live up to POSI. That's the principles of open scholarly infrastructure. So you'll see us go through these and you'll know we'll get to simplify and enrich services towards the end. So please hang on for that because we have a few exciting things to announce there as well. And we're putting the label for each one in the top right hand corner of each screen so you can see where we are for the next hour or so. So first up, I think Jeffrey's going to talk through the principles of open scholarly infrastructure and what we're doing to meet those and be accountable to them. So over to Jeffrey. No, we're not. We're going to talk about bolster the team, and Amanda is going to do that. Thank you for the prompt.
Hi, everyone. I'm Amanda. I look after the member experience team here at Crossref. But today I'm actually going to be talking about one of our newest goals, bolster the team, which is actually all about our staff. So over the last year or so, we've been focusing on two key areas, recruitment and team integration and function. So on the recruitment side, we've been very successful with our recruitment efforts and we've added three new hires. Mike and Fabienne joined our tech and product teams respectively, and Arlie Soto became a contractor for the outreach team. On the team integration and function side, we've been focusing on our equity practices. We've improved our diversity and inclusion efforts, particularly with hiring practices. We've used more job boards and hashtags for underrepresented groups, and we've had 1 week exclusivity to job boards for underrepresented groups. Due to the pandemic, we've had to close our offices and we've transitioned to having staff work remotely, and we've consciously changed our practices to accommodate this. We've also undertaken respectful workplace training. This is something we've not done before, but it is going to be necessary as we continue to have more dispersed staff across different countries, states, time zones. And this will now be done on an annual basis. So what's up next? Well, we'll continue to move forward with our goal and priority tracking work. If we move on to the next slide, you can see the full team there. We're still quite a small team. There's only 41 members of the team. If you want to find out more about anyone, you can see this org chart and a little bit more information about everybody on our website. And over to Jeffrey.
Thank you. I had a bit of a panic back there. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the principles of open scholarly infrastructure. I'm not going to go into great detail about what the principles of open scholarly infrastructure are, but I will point you instead to the Open Scholarly Infrastructure website and also to a blog post that we did on December 2nd of 2020, in which we announced that in the November board meeting, the Crossref board had agreed to adopt and endorse the principles for open scholarly infrastructure. In a nutshell, the principles for open scholarly infrastructure are a set of principles that are designed to help the community feel assured that any infrastructure that they depend on is going to be responsive to their needs and to their concerns. One of the big things about infrastructure is that lots of people depend on it. It's a risk to depend on it. And when we're working with the community, we want to be able to assure the community that we take that risk seriously and that they always have transparency into our system and the option ultimately to leave the system if they feel like Crossref for some reason is not meeting their needs or has become alienated from the community. So one of the things that we did when we announced this was we published a self-audit that we did of Crossref to see how closely we met the principles for open scholarly infrastructure at the moment. And the audit, again, which is published in December and which you can look at, revealed that we meet a lot of them, which is not entirely surprising because the principles were based on a lot of activity, a lot of practices that Crossref already exemplified. But there were a few places where we felt like we needed to improve. And this is one of the points of the principles, is that they're not something that you sign up to because you believe that you've, you know, meet all of the principles immediately and that you will forever. But they're a set of principles that you are going to aspire to, and that once you reach, you're committing to maintain, right? And so these kinds of self-audits are very important. And the self-assessment that we did looked at a few things. And really what we highlighted was that there were a few places where we needed to improve things. The first was to address our governance, right? To make sure that our governance actually reflected the community and the membership that was joining Crossref. And to this end, one of the things that we concluded was that as our membership has diversified, we need to actually expand our representation on the board and committees to better represent that membership. And so one of the remits now for the nominations committee has been to put together a slate for board elections that tries to include other constituencies. And in particular, one of the things that we're looking to try and include on the slate is funders. The other place where Crossref probably needs to up its game as far as the principles go has to do with sustainability. Now, Crossref has for a very long time maintained a 9-month reserve that we can use in case something goes drastically wrong and we need to weather a downturn in the economy or a radical change in technology or some other disruption that we can't anticipate. But the principles state that for infrastructure, particularly for infrastructure where it's so critical and so important, that actually a probably more realistic timeframe is 12 months. And so one of the things that we're going to be doing is trying to increase our reserve so that they can actually keep us operating for an entire year, even without any additional income. Another thing that we sort of were lacking on in the sustainability front was being more transparent about our operations and particularly about our internal operations. So one of the things that you're going to see and that you'll already have seen is that we're publishing more information about more financial information, and that we're going to be publishing more and more about our operations, our hiring practices, and so on and so forth. Another two areas that we really needed to focus on were open data and open source. And these are two principles in the principles for open scholarly infrastructure that guarantee what we call the forkability of infrastructure. That is, they guarantee that nobody is necessarily locked in to using a certain infrastructure. So the first thing that we're going to do is make it absolutely explicit that the data that we make available via our APIs is open to reuse, and we're going to make it explicit under what conditions, right? So, for example, a lot of our data is considered facts and is not, and we consider it not copyrightable at all. But there's other data in our metadata, things like abstracts that are subject to copyright, but that our terms and conditions state that you can reuse by virtue of the fact that they're in our API. So we're going to be doing some more work around clarifying that. The last thing, and this is something that Joe mentioned earlier, was that even though Almost all of our source code for any new projects developed since 2007 has been open. The legacy system itself has not been open. And one of the barriers to opening that is that we've got to go through and we've got to scrub it of any copy, you know, of any problematic copyright code, of any security issues and so on and so forth. But the goal is to actually make that source code available openly as well later in the year. So these are really the fundamentals of the principles for open scholarly infrastructure. As I said, this is an ongoing process. So when we reach these address these principles, the big challenge is going to be for us to maintain them. And the reason that we publicly commit to them is to allow the community to check and make sure that we are in fact adhering to those principles with the decisions that we make on the services that we provide. And we hope that that will increase the community's ability to trust us as infrastructure that they depend on. So that's it for POSI. I'm going to hand back to, I think, Ginny again.
Yes, thank you. Thanks, Jeffrey. So we are now on the second or third now of our six goals. So we've covered bolster the team and our commitment to the POSI principles. And next up is all around how we're engaging with new, expanding, and of course, established communities. So this goal centers on growth, scale, that was referenced earlier, strengthening relationships, community facilitation, and communications and content. So we have 14,000 members now, soon to be 15,000, and managing that growth is key for this year. So there are a lot of ongoing activities to manage that and plan for our future. But what we are going to do is focus just on a couple of things that have happened lately. So I will first introduce Vanessa to talk about the community forum.
Hi, everyone. So I'm Vanessa. I am Community Engagement Manager at Crossref. And I'm just going to talk to you briefly about our new community forum. So after undertaking some research, including sending out a survey to a cross section of our membership and beta testing the platform with a small group of users, we have officially launched our community forum back in February of this year. So the forum's hosted on open source discussion platform Discourse, and you can find it at community.crossref.org. The goal of the forum is to create an open and inclusive space where Crossref members, ambassadors, sponsors, service providers, and others can come together, have discussions, share experiences and expertise, and hopefully truly connect. The forum helps us to provide a more open, collaborative form of problem solving, allowing people to engage across different time zones and different languages, posting questions to be able to be answered by Crossref staff, ambassadors, or other community members. Members can also join discussion threads, volunteer for working groups, beta testing projects, help co-create materials, and provide feedback on new developments. A good example of this is that we had a call to action recently to translate our welcome email into different languages, and this resulted in our community translating it into 13 different languages, including Russian, Portuguese, French, Indonesian, and Chinese, among others. And we do currently have a call for feedback about content registration tools. So if you want to have a look there, you'll see there's lots of discussion and suggestions from the community. However, building a community is not an overnight task. It takes time and effort, and we are seeing some steady and slowly increasing usage. And we do hope this will continue as we move forwards, especially as we continue to further integrate the forum into our future activities and communications. So we hope to see you there. And now I'm going to hand over to Rachel Lamy, who's going to talk to you a bit more about funder engagement.
That's great. Thank you, Vanessa. Vanessa talked a lot about community in the previous slide, and certainly building a community takes work, and metadata and identifiers in Crossref aren't really anything without that. So part of the work that we've been doing has been working with funders over really since the creation of the funder registry in 2012, but that work has been catalyzed by supporting the registration of grants with Crossref, which we started to accept towards the end of 2019. Open grant metadata and identifiers integrated throughout publication workflows and connected to outputs like preprints, data, and more will just help better connect them to the scholarly record. And in turn, that stands to improve things like reporting on the outputs of funding and to help streamline the processes of doing so for funders, for researchers, research offices, and anyone who uses this information. We work with the funder advisory group, and I can see a couple of you on this call, and we're seeing funders join Crossref to register grants from Wellcome in the UK to ARDC in Australia, via the United States, Ireland, France, Japan, and more. We're also working on a funder perceptions project to explore how we can better support funder needs. And one early iteration of that is that this engagement is already informing our approach to sort of simple, responsive content registration user interfaces. And we'll talk about that later in the call. So we've got over 18,000 grants registered from around 20 funders, which is a great start, and we will certainly see further growth in this area over the next couple of months. And it's also complementary to work that DataCite and ORCID are doing to link researchers and contributors with research outputs. So we're in good company with this work. So if you want to find out more, there's a link to the page on the website there. And I'll pass over to back to Ginny to talk about improving metadata.
Thanks very much. We're a few minutes behind, so I'm going to move straight on to the next theme, which is improving and enriching our metadata. And Amanda is first up.
Thanks, Ginny. So we've been part of the Metadata 2020 project from the start, and it's always focused on improving metadata, but it was recently repositioned as an advocacy campaign, building on the outputs of the working groups over the last few years and tying metadata quality to the United Nations sustainability goals. We know that without richer, connected and reusable open metadata, goals like ending poverty around the world will take longer and zero hunger will remain just a hope. You can find out a lot more about this on their website. So that's metadata2020.org. And you can also sign the pledge there to promise to do your bit too. And now, what part does Crossref have to play in improving metadata? Well, I think Brian and Rachel are going to be telling us a bit more.
I can certainly start, yes, thank you. So Patricia Feeney can't be here today, she's based in the US, she's our head of metadata, but I'll give some updates on the schema changes that are imminent or planned. You'll remember that maybe about 12 months ago we had a public consultation on the changes we were considering making to the Crossref input schema, registration schema, and thank you for all of the feedback you gave us on that. We are verging on, very close to, support for the RAW identifier, so the research organization identifier. Those tickets to be able to allow the change to the schema and for people to register that institutional identifier for the affiliations is currently in development. So we hope to have that ready very, very soon. And we've got a group of members ready to test the submission of that. Other institutional identifiers will also be supported at the same time. So ISNI and Wikidata identifiers. We're also planning how to make those identifiers available through the REST API as well, so the output side of things. I should have said that we were also expanding affiliations. So right now, a contributor in the metadata can have one affiliation. We're expanding that so that you can have multiple affiliations for a single contributor. The other changes around contributors will be to do with roles. So we're preparing to support the credit taxonomy, allowing multiple roles in the contributor metadata to reflect the type of work the contributors have put into that work. We'll also be adding support for an expanded set of contributor IDs themselves, so ISNI and Wikidata. We already support ORCID IDs, of course, and that's been around for a while. And then one of the other major things that we'll be doing is improving citations metadata. So we'll be adding support for citations where you can supply a type for the citation. So that will really help to identify data citations within the metadata that that we get. The final piece of work, which we've just started, we're working with a contractor to create a complete JATS to Crossref transformation script. So we know that a lot of our members who are journal publishers, but all kinds of publishers, may have their XML in JATS format already. So yeah, we're working with the contractor to have this complete JATS to Crossref transformation. We have a simple transformation at the moment, which requires you to upload the JATS file manually to our system, and you have to upload it one by one. And it doesn't support the full range of features in JATS. So this is work that we've just started. It will be a more robust solution, which will allow you to register a richer metadata, including abstracts and raw IDs and credits. So these are all detailed on our roadmap, and we'll keep that roadmap updated so you can see how we're doing. And I'm going to hand back to...
to me.
Rachel, hey.
Yeah. Rachel. So you can see that we're coming at improving metadata from a number of angles, which Brian's just talked about. This is the idea of community source corrections is one that's sort of been bubbling along for a while, and it's sort of been catalyzed recently by some community discussions about things like the population and dissemination of metadata about retractions, so that they can populate through different workflows. A lot of you know that when you register content with Crossref, it's a major source of information to third parties like citation management systems, scholarly sharing networks, and other databases. But a lot of the queries that we get are about issues with metadata. And we have a procedure if people mention that there's an addition or an issue with metadata. Essentially, what we do is we collect those reports and forward them to the publisher. So it's difficult to see what's happening with those, and we'd like to sort of open up that process a bit. And we also know it's more difficult than we'd like it to be for our members to update metadata. So one of the ways that we're looking at that is to crowdsource or community source metadata corrections from a range of sources and feed those back in a way that's visible, but makes it easy for members to accept or reject these suggested changes. And that's just so that everyone can benefit from more complete and accurate information. That's really where we'd like to get to. The thing that I'd say is this is very exploratory at this stage, but it is something that we'll be digging into more in the next couple of months. So watch this space. Back to you, Jenny.
Thank you, Rachel. Yeah, so there's a lot of initiatives about how we and others in the community are helping to enrich metadata. So speaking of others, our next goal is all around partnering and collaborating with like-minded organizations and initiatives. So we've always collaborated, but we want to purposefully do that more closely to solve problems together. And we're going to now talk about a few that have some news or are making progress recently. And back to Rachel for the first one. I already put the link to RAW in the chat, and she's going to talk us through how that collaboration is going.
Cool. So The fact that ROAR's already come up a couple of times is just shows that it's a really key project that that Crossref is supporting, and you'll have already heard lots about it in the section about metadata. So, as an overview, ROAR, or the Research Organisations Registry, has been really busy. They recently hired an adoption lead, Liz Kersnarich, who's working to support, as it suggests, the adoption of ROAR, supporting additional metadata. So based on GRID in the ROAR API and the data dump, they're working hard to implement both the technical and the community sides of the curation workflow so that the ROAR registry can be updated over time as it grows, and finding things like an API users group and adoption working group. SID ROAR is a community owned project, so it's really important that that everyone has a voice in terms of that. It said we are big fans of ROAR at Crossref, so accepting ROAR IDs in our schema and connecting those to a range of research outputs, making them available via our APIs and supporting those across our other tools is really going to aid adoption and help connect those outputs to the affiliations of those creating them. We'll be talking more about this at the end of September. And I'm also giving congratulations to some of our funder members who are already including ROAR IDs in the grant schema, which supports ROAR now. So more to come, and please join us at the end of September where we'll dig into this a bit more. I'm also, on behalf of my colleague Susan, covering our work with the Public Knowledge Project. And we've been collaborating with PKP for a few years now, because we want to make it easier for our many members who use the OJS publishing platform to access and use Crossref services. This has included both the development of Crossref related plugins for OJS for things like content registration, reference linking, deposits, funding information, as well as PKP being a valuable part of our sponsor program. In 2019, we began regular working group calls between PKP and Crossref. And in 2020, we signed an MOU to formalize our partnership. So included in that is a statement of work for the continued development of Crossref Open Journal Systems integrations and improvement to existing plugins, as well as documentation, because that's an important part of it. A plugin for our Cited By service has been developed, and we'll have formal documentation on implementation for that very soon. Improvements to the existing plugin, and we're also looking at something to support Crossmark. There's no definitive time frame for that release, but most likely quarter four this year. As said, you can link out to the PKP's blog post on their 3.4 release, which is due in quarter three or quarter four, which consolidates the Crossref related plugins in one place, improves the DOI management and interface for articles and issues, so it's just more intuitive, and it'll put it all on one screen. So it'll make it easier for you to identify where DOIs are missing and give quick tools to generate and deposit those in bulk. So we're really excited about that, because it will provide a much better workflow for our many members who use OJS. So keep an eye on developments in that, and we hope to have more in that soon. But as I said, we recognise that it's really important for a lot of our members. Ginny, I think you're going to talk about our collaboration with DOAJ.
I am. Yes, thank you. So another MOU, a Memorandum of Understanding, just was signed in the last few days, and that's with DOAJ, the Directory of Open Access Journals. I'm sure everybody's heard of DOAJ. We've been working with them for a little while. We talk about metadata with them a lot, and we have started talking a lot more about our overlap in members and the new and emerging, usually journals, that we are supporting. And we have gaps on both sides that we want to start to address. So we want to work more closely together on data analysis and on outreach to identify countries or communities that need more support. So our shared goal is to lower barriers around the world to participating in the global scholarly infrastructure system. And this quote from Lars, who's the founder and managing director of DOAJ, sums it up really nicely. Together, we stand a greater chance of encouraging an open, fair, and fully inclusive future for scholarly publishing. So that's going to be announced officially next week. So you've got the scoop here today. And you'll hear more about what we're working on with DOAJ in the coming months and years. So an even more established relationship next is with ORCID. So Brian is now going to give an update specifically on ORCID auto update.
Yeah, thanks, Ginny. Just a very quick update on ORCID auto update. So this is a classic example of open infrastructure at work. When our members include ORCID IDs within their works, so an ORCID ID is an individual identifier, it helps to uniquely identify the authors of a particular work. Our members can include that within the contributors field in the metadata. When they register their content with us and it includes an ORCID ID, when we detect it, we can automatically push the work to the author's ORCID profile. So that helps authors, it saves them time from having to do this work manually. It helps publishers because it's a valuable service that they can provide. It also helps funders and research institutions, administrators and librarians to track research outputs for their researchers. I love this quote, this tweet from Dr. Elizabeth Gadd. They posted a preprint to SOC Archive, and SOC Archive had registered that work with Crossref. It included her ORCID ID, and so we pushed the work to her ORCID profile, and all of that took 35 minutes. So there was just magic happening. She published her preprint, and it was already immediately in her ORCID profile, which I think is great. So far, we've pushed more than 6 million works to ORCID IDs. So that tells you the scale of this. What's really interesting is that nearly half of that, 2.7 million, has been pushed in the last 12 months alone. So our members are increasingly including ORCID IDs within their metadata. And so increasingly, we're able to save more and more authors' time. We have to get permission from the author to be able to do this. So the first time we try, they get an invitation, they get an email, they get a message into their ORCID inbox asking them to authorize Crossref to do this. All time around 50% of authors have accepted that, which is fantastic. So we're doing a lot of work to try to drive that up, to explain more who we are and what the service is doing, the value it's providing to them. And I can say in the last quarter of last year, we had managed to get that number up to nearly 60% of authors accepting our requests. And over in the bottom right, you can see a table of the change from the first quarter of last year to the first quarter of this year. Really significant increase in the use of ORCID auto update. So if you're a Crossref member and you don't currently include ORCID identifiers for the authors of the work, please try to do that. Please try to validate them as well. But if you include those ORCID IDs, then we can update the profile for your authors and researchers. And so I think, Ginny, I will hand back to you for the start of Simplify Services.
Yes, and this is the section. There's lots of questions coming in now about our systems and about Elasticsearch, and we're going to cover all of that stuff now in this final section about our last but definitely not least goal, which is to try to make it easier to interact with Crossref, essentially. So this is simplify services. Brian presented the roadmap earlier. You can see we're getting organized, communicating things more clearly, and focusing much more closely and making it clear to people what we're using. So this goal is all about delivering easy to use tools that are really important for you all. All this invisible work has been happening behind the scenes to strengthen our code base and underlying infrastructure. And now we're going to talk about all of the initiatives that have either just taken place or are very imminent in the next couple of months. So I know Sarah, the product manager, is not awake yet. So Carlos, the developer, is going to first talk a little bit about our new authentication model. Over to you, Carlos.
Thank you, Ginny. Hi, everyone. I'm Carlos Dojo. I'm software developer here at Crossref, and I'm the tech lead for the authentication project. So the authentication project is one of the sort of invisible behind the scenes projects we've been working on in order to improve the authentication process to Crossref tools and services. So recently in April, we've rolled out the authenticator, which is a new tool for logging in within our services. So probably most of you haven't noticed, but that's been an important change in our core infrastructure and software. So it was quite critical, but you probably have just noticed a new login box for those who access the admin panel. And one of our top priorities was that these changes should not affect at all to our existing members. So they shouldn't have to change credentials. They shouldn't have to change scripts, automation scripts for using our services. And it should be like a very smooth move towards a new authentication process. So for existing members, you have continued authenticating with our shared role credentials. So your organization has one login and one password shared among your team. And what we have introduced is the user credentials. And what are the user credentials? The user credentials is basically that every user within your organization will be able to log in using their email address and a password, and then we'll be able to select a role. But that will still work in parallel with the legacy / previous mechanism, which was the shared role credentials, right? With you only have a login and a password. So this change entails more flexibility, more simplicity, more security. So flexibility is more flexible because if one of member of your organization forgets a password, the entire organization is not locked out, right? It's simpler because users have one password but can have many roles, right? And it's more secure because vendors and third parties can have their own credentials. So those who should no longer have access can have their permissions revoked. So we've improved our technology, caught up with new current standards, pay down some technical debt, and we're just trying to move to a more modular and flexible architecture. So this change has been slow, deliberately slow, and it's been rolled out in phases to our members. So currently the new standalone, which are non-sponsor or sponsoring members, are set up with user credentials. So the new system with email address, password, and roles assigned to them. And existing members can continue using their shared roles and credentials, and sponsor members are using role credentials as well. So there are some additional features needed to roll out to the rest of the membership, and these will be addressed in the next phase of this project, which I'm going to introduce now. So the next phase of the authentication project is moving towards a role-based access management system. So this diagram on this slide describes a role-based access control in a simple way. So role-based access management assigns users to roles, and roles have permissions or rights to certain actions. It will give our members more control over who can access and take actions on their accounts, and can manage these users themselves without needing to contact our support team. So this schema you see here is not necessarily what we will implement exactly, but describes in a simple way the purpose of role-based access management. So the technology team is now working on exploring sort of state-of-the-art current modern solutions for role access management control, right? That can work out of the box. We're trying not to build it from scratch, because that's a very, very, I mean, it's a big project, and I think nowadays this is already a solved problem that we can rely on. So we will need to do this in conjunction with the development of a new community data model. So we're trying to put together everything like who are the users, the members, the prefixes, how do they relate to each other, who's our sponsoring organizations, who do they sponsor, what accounts can they administer, which DOIs can they deposit, query, etc. And we are trying to redefine the whole model that fits better to all these requirements, to all these relationships. And the implementation of this model is crucial to our platform, as all our services and products basically will rely on that. So that's it on my side, and I'm going to pass it to Dominika, who will talk about the REST API.
Thank you, Carlos. Hello, everyone. My name is Dominika, and I am, among other things, the tech lead of the Crossref REST API. Today, I'd like to share with you what we've been working on for a while now. I will expand a little bit on a few of the things mentioned earlier by my colleagues. Our REST API receives a lot of traffic. That's around 300 million requests per month across three pools. And scaling the system to meet demand and also extending the API to cover new emerging use cases have been increasingly challenging, especially given our existing architecture and infrastructure. Some issues have been easier to diagnose and fix than others, but in general, we've been quite limited in the options available to maintain acceptable service levels. So to address this, we've been working on effectively two substantial changes. One is replacing the solar search engine behind the REST API with Elasticsearch. The second one is moving from hosting the application on dedicated hardware in a data center to a cloud platform, AWS. While working on these changes, we've aimed to maintain feature parity, avoid introducing breaking changes, and keep service disruptions to a minimum. But even keeping the status quo from an end user perspective still takes a lot of work, not to mention constantly juggling competing priorities. We can change the slide now. Admittedly, the project has been going on for a long time. We needed to keep the application stable in order to have any chance of success. So we've had to say no to some non-critical bug fixes and new feature requests until the migration is complete. Even so, we still had to carve out time to troubleshoot problems with the existing API. We deprecated some features that were causing problems. We reallocated hardware from the public pool to the polite pool to improve stability. And we also constantly had to identify and temporarily block problematic clients. If you haven't seen the two bits of documentation linked on the slide, that's the etiquette section of the main docs and the relatively new API tips document, please be sure to check them out. Currently, we are almost ready to begin cutting over to the Elasticsearch backed API. The feature parity was achieved earlier this year. Now we are conducting performance and load testing with existing traffic mirrored to the new infrastructure so that we can fine tune it. We are testing the new service internally and will soon be testing with partners and the public. And we are planning to cut over pool by pool with the ability to roll back quickly if necessary. So make sure to keep an eye on the Crossref blog and social media channels for a more detailed announcement in the coming weeks. After the cutover, we hope to keep up a steady pace of improvements and fixes, starting with support for retrieving grants metadata through the REST API. Over the last few months, we pulled together the specification for grant support, and we are already making good progress on the implementation. Then we will keep working through our prioritized backlog, which you can find via the Crossref roadmap. We plan to focus on the highest priority bugs and discrepancies after support for grants has been delivered. So thanks to all the Crossref staff who have worked on this project. And last but not least, huge thanks to our API user community for your endless support and patience. And now I'll hand over to Panos, who will talk about event data.
Hello, everyone. My name is Panos Pandis. I'm the lead developer for Event Data. Event Data is a publicly accessible service that we provide in Crossref, which tries to link our Crossref registered DOIs to mentions of these on the internet in various sources, from social media to Wikipedia to partners like DataCite. it has grown to around 737 million events since starting in 2017. We have experienced a huge growth, moving from 2 million events to 20 million new events per month. And currently we support 12 sources. On the bottom right corner, you may see an example from Wikipedia, where, for example, we can see that DOIs are mentioned in references of Wikipedia. So next slide, please. What we have noticed is that event data has a huge potential, but throughout the years, we have quickly surpassed our initial design and outgrown ourselves. So at the moment, we are working on constructing our path to the future by trying to update our server infrastructure and improving stability, consolidating our sources, and constructing a future roadmap. In the past year, we have focused a lot on stability and managed to get much better uptime. And we would love to evaluate and plan ahead for the use and the features of our sources and think about future sources. What we have managed to do since our last update is to, very importantly, update our list of prefix domain mappings. So oftentimes you may be able to detect a DOI on the internet, but this DOI resolves back to usually a publisher's domain or some other source that we can identify. And it is very useful when we can also search for these domains when we don't find the actual DOI, but we can still find useful information that references what the DOI would point to. And there are plans for trying to improve this significantly in the future. We have updated and improved several of our existing sources, most notably our Crossref metadata agent source. And in our next steps moving forward, we are planning to focus on infrastructure and improve our support for data citation. The first step has already been taken, and we want to improve further upon this and reassess our sources and our future options, see how we can add more value to our existing sources and think about future sources that will cover more ground. And I'd like to pass over to Fabienne.
Hello, I'm Fabienne, the product manager for Similarity Check at Crossref. For those of you who are unfamiliar with Similarity Check, it's a content comparison tool to detect potential cases of plagiarism. It's powered by Authenticate, produced by Turnitin, and available exclusively to Crossref members. It allows Similarity Check users to compare documents against internet sources, as well as against around 78 million full text documents contributed by Crossref members. Similarity Check is seeing a healthy user growth, plus 167 members compared to last year, and an increase in the number of documents checked. We know Similarity Check users have been waiting a long time for a new version of Authenticate, and you'll be very happy to hear that we're now very close to releasing it. There are a number of new features. It has a cleaner and more engaging interface, a new content portal to allow users to check their indexed content and fix indexing errors, a simplified view of matches, new citations and preprint sources exclusion filters, an increased document upload capacity, a Google Drive document upload functionality, and a brand new annotation feature currently available in private mode only. So this is a preview of the new Similarity report. So what it will look like, the layout is similar to version one. The manuscript is on the left-hand side, the match is on the right-hand side, but it has a much fresher, cleaner interface. It also provides the overall similarity score at the top of the report, and the red flag signals the use of hidden text or suspicious characters. We will be releasing the new version of Authenticate in stages, first to native users, that's to say users who are logging in directly via the Authenticate website. From the end of quarter two, new Similarity Check members will automatically have access to the new version of Authenticate. And then we will start migrating existing members from version one to version two in the second part of the year. We're currently working with peer review system providers to prepare for the migration of Similarity Check users accessing Authenticate via Manuscript Tracking System Platform, or MTS. eJournal Press and Editorial Manager have version 2 on their roadmap already for this year, and we're hoping others will soon follow suit. From quarter three, we will be working with members who integrate directly through their own system by an API, and we'll be supporting them with their V2 integration. In phase two, we are planning to release new or enhanced features and give Similarity Check users the ability to save and share reports with authors, make public and private annotations, manage parent-child accounts to give Crossref sponsor members an overview of the organizations they sponsor, and investigate the detection of image manipulation. So some very exciting developments ahead. And I'm now going to hand you over to Patrick, who is going to talk about content registration.
Thank you, Fabienne. Hi, my name's Patrick Vale. I'm the relatively new front-end developer at Crossref. I joined earlier this year. So one of the things that I've been tasked with doing since I've arrived is looking at the way that we build user interfaces at Crossref, and particularly how we might build content registration user interfaces going forward. So the bulk of content that's registered with us is done programmatically. So that's machines talking to other machines. But plenty of our members don't have the technical expertise to do that. So for those members, we provide helper tools. Examples of that would be Metadata Manager or Simple Text Query. Now, each of those helper tools has its own use cases and its own limitations. That can lead to a confusing and inconsistent experience for members. What we want to do is to create a unified experience across all of those content types. We've begun prototyping a new content registration user interface, a UI, and that will eventually replace both Metadata Manager and the web deposit form. Our strategy for this new tool is very heavily influenced by the lessons learned from both Metadata Manager and web deposit. With our new tool, we're taking a strong community focus. So that means we're going to design for small. So the target audience for this tool is our smaller members who often lack both the technical expertise and indeed the staff to create XML by themselves. And our helper tool should help lower that barrier. We also want to, from the very start, support accessibility and also localization. So that will translate into support for major international accessibility guidelines and standards, and also allow for translation of our user interface into multiple local languages from the very outset to meet the needs of our increasingly global membership. We also want to work in the open. So as Jeffrey and Joe spoke earlier, we want to make all this code open source. So we want to build in the open, both for transparency, but also so that others can contribute ideas and improvements and make their needs clear to us. We're also taking a very user-centered design. So we want to unify our user interfaces, simplifying the tools that members use by providing one place to go to register all your content. We also want to be able to rapidly iterate. So that's kind of my area of providing a technical solution that allows for rapid development of user interfaces to support new content types, but also to support new versions of our schema as we release updates to that. We also want to build the right features for the right users. The core users of our helper tools are our smaller members, so we'll tailor the feature set to solve the problems that our smaller members face. We also want to build content for the future. So that means we'll take a tactical approach to the content types that we support. We're going to quickly build user interfaces in a very strategic order. We can't support every content type at once, so we'll identify and build in the areas of the highest impact and the lowest effort to start with. We'll also take a very deliberate approach to the fields that we support. So not all members will supply metadata for all fields in our schema. So we'll identify and we'll support the most used and also the most useful fields first, and then we can add more in future iterations if that proves necessary. We've also redesigned Simple Text Query to a new and more powerful tool, and we will rename that Match References. We are very much actively seeking feedback about this. So there is an excellent thread on our community forum called Feedback on the New Helper Tool. That's in the Questions from Crossref section. I'm keeping a very close eye on that thread. And thank you to everyone who's responded to that. Every time there's a new reply, it gives me a new angle and insight into how you use the tools. So please do read that thread and add your own experiences. I'd really appreciate that. Also, there's a great blog post by Sarah that was mentioned earlier on our forum, Sarah Bowman, about the history behind this decision. So please go and check that out as well. And I'll now hand back to Ginny.
Thank you so much, Patrick, and everybody. It's great to hear from the product managers and the developers who've been working on all of these new initiatives. So we've got 9 minutes left for questions. There's none open, but please speak now or forever. You know how it works. I did want to maybe touch on one of the questions from Herwig. Could you elaborate a little bit about the resilience of the Crossref system? So from a policy and technical standpoint, so certainly policy-wise, the POSI principles are helping with, you know, long-term sustainability insurance. And as part of our operations and regular practice, we do have a risk register that we review with our board every year. So we're preparing that now. And in our July board meeting, we're going to look through those risks. Some of them are financial, some of them are community-based, and some of them are technical. So I don't know if Jeffrey, you want to jump on and just talk about our fallback solutions and possibly decentral systems.
Right. So I think one thing that's useful from a technical perspective is to distinguish between the part that's run by Crossref and the part that's run, that is the DOI system, not run by the DOI Foundation, but run on behalf of the DOI Foundation by CNRI. And that's the handle system. That system is responsible for actually resolving DOI. So when you actually click on one, it goes to the proper DOI, to the proper page. That's a hugely redundant, scalable system. DOIs are just a fraction of the identifiers that are built on the handle system. And it's distributed, it's robust, it's stood up very well over time and scaled tremendously. The other part is our technology stack, and that's the things like the content registration, the APIs for collecting metadata, and the user interfaces. And I guess the fundamental answer is that one of the biggest reasons that we're trying to move to the cloud is that despite yesterday's outage with Fastly, it is still just about the most reliable way to run software at scale, right? At the moment, we run a bunch of our system in a data center. And the data center is itself a risk, right? Recently was that it's one of the only places at the moment where our staff has had to physically go over the past year when everybody's been in lockdown, right? And this, you know, this kind of, you know, and this kind of stuff, this, you know, racking machines, changing hard drives, you know, patching, firewalls and things like that. this is not our core competency. We've got to get out of that. We've got to move to a place where that is handled sort of at scale and by lots of people, and where lots of other people depend on it. There's a sort of a mutuality there that's important. So part of the reason that we're moving to the cloud is to actually improve our scalability and to improve our resiliency in that front. At the moment, it's a mixed bag. We've got a bunch of stuff that runs in the cloud, a bunch of stuff that runs in the data center, and then a bunch of stuff that runs via the handle system. And the goal, of course, is to strengthen that. I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much. Another question has just come in about the timing of retiring metadata manager. I can see Martin is typing an answer, but we can also just answer that live. We're aiming for the end of the year. We won't retire it until we have the new, more flexible replacement, of course. But in the meantime, you can use the web deposit form as well. So if you contact support@crossref.org, we can make sure you have the right links and help you with the XML. So there's a couple of questions about authenticate. I don't know if Fabienne or Brian, you want to take a look at those. I see, Brian, you've marked it, the one from Johannes.
Yes, I can answer that one. It's a good question because we have an answer for it. we also had reports from editors that they can find high similarity scores matching to the author's own preprint, and preprints are increasingly an early form of communication. In fact, we had an author contact us because his work had been rejected by a journal because of a high similarity match. We've been working with Turnitin. We've developed a list of known preprint servers, and there will now be a new exclusion filter for preprints. So if you get a high similarity match, you can exclude preprints. We would like you to look at the preprints to make sure that it is actually genuinely the same author and the same title, the same article, but you can exclude preprints. I think Fabian might correct me, but that should complete development next week, and it will be available in V2. It won't be available in version 1, so it will be available in version 2.
Great, thank you. All right, I think with a couple of minutes to spare, we are maybe going to close. I wanted to just end with wrapping up by saying a big thank you to all the Crossref staff, who some of whom got up quite early or were up very late, and also to all of you attendees, who are also some of you on the west coast of the US or in Australia. It's midnight now for you, so go to bed. And we are going to start our day here in Europe. We will follow up with the recording, with the slides themselves, and with a curated list of links that we've mentioned today. So thanks again. And stay in touch. There's a number of ways to stay in touch. The main one is to email us or look at our community forum and website. Okay. I'll let everybody get on with their evenings and days. Thanks so much. Take care. Bye.